ethics. First of all, they ask, what is the purpose? So this shouldn't be difficult. So this kind of question, I always believe you bluff also can be, as long as you can bluff with a logical point. Why do you need a code of ethics? But of course, when you ask to explain the purpose of the code, you must know what code is there. Because if you are asked about a code of conduct for the worker, then the purpose is to control the worker. If this is the code for the company's conduct, then it should control the business. So you must know which code they're saying. So to know which code, they must read the question. From reading the question, you know. Okay? Now then they ask you, what are the typical content? Leave you bluff or so easy 9 marks for student. Okay? Now then part B. Strategic positioning. It's about the way the company as a whole is placed in its environment and concerns its fit with the factors in the environment. So we reference to the case as appropriate. Explain how a code can be used as part, how a code can be used as part of a company. It's a very straightforward, easy line. But can you see or not? A lot of the easier students got eyes but blind. Okay, assess Hawke's belief that employer child labor is always wrong. From deontological and teleological perspective. See, this examiner very nice, you know. He scared student will mix up. That's why all the while when he uses deontological and teleological, one of it, he will write down whether which is consequentialist and non-consequentialist. So like that, you know, okay. Don't mix up, can see, you know? If he just write like that, I can tell you a lot of students all don't know. So the whole thing wrong. Imagine you write the thing mix up, the whole thing wrong already, okay? So that's why he tell you, okay? Now, pork products based in the developing country was recently wholly acquired by American Overseas Investment, AOI, a North American holding company. And the new owners took the opportunity to complete the review of HPC's management culture and system. And one of the first things that AOI questioned was HPC long-standing corporate code of ethics. Now the board of AOI said that it had a general code of ethics that HPC as AOI subsidiary should adopt. Simon Hawke, the chief executive of HPC, disagreed, however, and explained why HPC should retain its existing code. Now he said that HPC had adopted its code of ethics in its home country, which is often criticized for its unethical business behavior. Some other companies in the country were criticized for their sweatshop condition. HPC's adoption of its code of ethics, however, meant that it could always obtain orders from the European customers on the guarantee that products were made ethically and in compliance with its own highly regarded code of ethics. Mr. Hawke explained that HPC had an outstanding ethical reputation, both locally and internationally, and that reputation could be threatened if it's forced to replace its existing code with AOI general code. When Ed Tanner, a senior director from AOI office, visited Mr. Hawke after the acquisition, he was shown HPC's operation in action. Mr. Hawke pointed out that unlike some other employers in the industry, HPC didn't employ child labor. Mr. Hawke explained that although it was allowed by the law in the country, it was forbidden by HPC code of ethics. Mr. Hawke also explained that in his view, employing child labor was always ethically wrong. Mr. Turner asked whether the money that children earn by working in the relatively safe condition at HPC was an important source of income for their family. And Hawke said that money was important to them, but even so, it's still wrong to employ children as it was exploitative and interfered with their education. He said that it would alienate the European customer who bought the HPC partly on the basis of his code of ethics. So first of all, you can see that when they refer to code here, they're referring to what? The workers' conduct or the business conduct? Which one? They're referring to the business conduct, because they're talking about the business itself need to adopt. They talk about child labor, correct not? So all this is not workers' conduct, but it's about business conduct. Okay, so that's the first part. A, yeah. Now I would start the answer by defining what is the code of ethics. Okay, that's what I'm gonna say. Okay, so I'm gonna start by defining what is the code of ethics. Okay, now, so after you define, now this is something that we say it become a framework that put limit to the behavior, and I would say in this case the entity, i.e. for example, HPC. Now, then you're going to write down purpose of. So, what's the purpose of a code? Now, of course, the purpose of the code is it will set the do's and the don'ts for the business entity. Example, like HPC does not employ child labor. Okay, so purpose is to set limit.
What else? What else can code do for us?
It's actually to communicate the ethical value of the business to the stakeholder. It's to communicate the ethical value to stakeholder. Now, example, you find that the customers at, they mentioned, right? The customers at the Europe side, buy HPC because of their ethical value. And of course, the code will directly encourage or instill a ethical culture, right? Okay, because when you have a code, you have a set of belief. So the belief will then be transferred and embedded into the worker. Yes, you know? So employee inside the entity will actually be influenced by the company's belief Okay, so all these are examples of what you can use a code for. So the most is the do's and don'ts. Okay, so to communicate the value, to embed, to create the culture. Okay, now all these can be some of the purpose of why we need a code. Okay, now, so what are the content?
Okay, so if you run through the note, the example I gave in the note is I take uni level, the code of their business principle, and if you run through their code, then you understand what the content is. Because they mentioned about how they deal with workers, how they deal with their suppliers, how they deal with their consumer, can you not? So you're gonna write down all that. So example, now the code will identify the key stakeholder and it will explain the expected behavior of a company towards the stakeholder. So example, you're gonna say to employee. Okay, what you're gonna say in terms of employee, so you're gonna elaborate. For example, like we're gonna put things like no discrimination, we're gonna give them freedom to association, they can join any so-called trade union, they can form trade union. Okay, we want to give them safe working environment, we want to promote knowledge enhancement, etc. Because you write more, you're gonna get more marks. So you know things that you can write a lot, you write a lot. Okay, so normally worker is one of the main stakeholders that they have very active involvement. That's why you will have to specify very clearly how we're gonna deal with the worker. Okay, now. So how are you gonna deal with shareholder? Now shareholder, we're gonna tell them, for example, like we're gonna run the business responsibly, okay, because we take care of the business for you. We will make sure that we will be transparent to you, we will not hide you. Okay, now to the government, for example, we will be compliant of the law, we avoid anything illegal. Maybe to the customer, that will give you safe product, we make sure that we have fair price to supplier, we expect them to comply and be consistent with our business principle. To community, example like our social responsibility, how we're gonna take care of the community. Now the list goes on, okay? So you're gonna write more, the more you can write, the more marks you're gonna get. Okay, so this is the first part. So the 9 marks are fairly easy. But actually you think it is a no case one. You know what it is, you can write. So the size of the points are all here. So what you need is just the time to make them into complete sentences. Okay, now, so look at what they ask here. Okay, bye. Bye. Now, strategic positioning is about the way the company as a whole is placed in the environment and concern is fit with the factors in the environment. And make reference to the case, how can the code can be used as part of the strategic positioning. Now actually what they're trying to ask, this is something that I can tell you, this is something you cannot learn.
Okay, because this kind of thing is you have to use your maturity to look at what they want in the question and answer. So what they are trying to say is, how do you think that by having a code of ethics, then you can have a strategic positioning? So actually, what is a strategic positioning? So strategic positioning is about how you position yourself strategically in the company. So normally, a strategic position could be, for example, your image. Now, for example, like what is AirAsia's strategic positioning? That whenever people look at AirAsia, they say, oh, AirAsia is the image, is the budget airline. So their positioning is make everyone have the chance to fly. So that's why they will make it very cheap, they offer free seats, this and that. So that's called strategic positioning. So you must have a positioning system in the company. And to have that position, you're going to do something. So now the question is, they ask you, if you have a code of ethics, how can you use a code to form this strategic positioning? Okay, first of all, now I will start by explaining in the answer, okay? I will explain what strategic positioning means. Okay? So it's about to position the business in the market to create a reputation that is embedded in the heart of our customers and stakeholder. Okay, so once you have a successful strategic positioning, then we can actually remind our customers or stakeholders about our value each time they think of us. Okay? Now, so I can give an example, like maybe the strategic positioning can be a cost leader. Okay, build a company that you show to people that you are cost leader. What is Volvo strategic positioning? Volvo. Think of Volvo car compared with other people's car. What do they say about Volvo? Volvo 嘅車係好咩？出名，出名硬啊！攞呢做硬揸嚟機車做硬啊！ Volvo 唔係出名硬，係出名安全。明白冇？啊，唔係硬，揸嚟機車都好硬嘅，仲安全啊！飛機撞落你都唔死啊 ！Okay， now。So Volvo has put a strategic positioning about safety. That's why Volvo, they always research about safety features. So every time when they got accident, they will send their research team to study why there was an accident, how the accident occurred. That's why Volvo is the pioneer in a lot of new technology. For example, if you see Ford copy a few technology of Volvo, you know the car can in front of the car will stop. This was Volvo technology. Volvo invented this many years back. So they know most of the time the accident is because you fall asleep, then you knock the car in front. So they program the computer that every time when you come very close to a car, they'll give you a warning. Now, if let's say you come closer, the warning you never put brake, they will brake for you to reduce your speed by 70%. So even though you hit, you won't die so badly. Probably you die lah, okay? So at least you can see that. Then they also are the one that they come up with technology. You know, every time when we drive, sometimes we play handphone. You know, society play handphone. You don't bother about what in front. So they install the camera in the car that they will monitor the surrounding. We call this as pedestrian safety. So if there's any human walk out and you didn't notice a human, the car will automatically stop for you. The car cannot go on. Because the idea is safety. So human life is the most important against anything. That's why if you want to be a sasawa, you cannot use Volvo car. Because whenever you want to drive and not a person, the car will stop. The car is programmed like that. So that is called strategic positioning. They have built a position that, wow, Volvo car, safe car. Can see that? So you will think that Air Asia, cheap. Something like that. Can see that? So your positioning can be cost leader, quality. So you can say that, for example, Volvo cars are made for safety. There's a lot of people don't buy Volvo car. They say buy Volvo car, number one, like very old fashioned, number two, no sell value. That's why Volvo say for life, it's not for you to sell. When you buy the car, you don't sell. Volvo is for life. Can see that? Okay. Now, so this is the call, the thing called strategic positioning. So if you look at HPC, it's strategic positioning in the market is what? The ethical reputation. Okay, the ethical reputation. Now, you see they mentioned what? AOI wanted HPC to adopt their general code. But after they adopt, the company being criticized, okay, the company is being criticized. That they say that your code is too general, so you just simply want to get something to please yourself. So that's why that shows that AOI code is not as good as theirs, because their code is much more comprehensive. Their code is much more better, that cover a lot of issues. So that's why to them is they want to have a strategic positioning about ethics. Now that's why they did mention that where is the part they mentioned HPC is better than the rest. HPC had an outstanding ethical reputation. Okay, HPC had an outstanding ethical reputation. So this is the position that they already created. And they are saying that this reputation can be threatened if they start to replace with the code. Can see, you know? So they say it must make a reference to the case. So the position is ethical reputation. Because the case mentioned that they have outstanding ethical reputation locally and internationally. Okay, now, but it is built, okay, it is built because, number one, HPC delivers, okay, HPC delivers, okay, the company ensures that the code is being implemented. Okay, the company ensure the code is being implemented. Now, for example, not to employ child labor, even though this is something legal. Okay? Even though this is something legal. Now, the moment you walk the talk,
then only people believe you. So you just say that we have a code, but you don't do. What's the point? Like Malaysia, our policemen don't have code. Our motto is what? Cekap amanah, something like that. Cepat cekap amanah. Then, so what? You have it, but you don't do. In front, you put a tag, tanah rasuah, but you ask me how much you want to give me. Correct now. So that's why when you have this thing, then useless one. But when you start to do what you say, then different. Then you add credibility. Yes, you know? So the moment you start to implement, then it adds credibility. It tells people that we are serious. Okay? So it tells the community that HPC is serious. This is about building
reputation.
And building reputation is not easy. You can spend years to build and you can destroy it in seconds. Okay? So that's why it takes time for them to build. So they have built this reputation over time. Okay?
And since they have built the reputation, now the public trusted HPC. That it upheld the code of ethics. So the code become a direct way to communicate to the stakeholder HPC behavior.
So now is the second stage. Okay? Because you deliver what you say and people know it. So every time when you tell people what is in the code, then people really believe in you. So if people start to believe in you, that means you have built your strategic positioning in terms of your ethical value.
So that's why now there's a problem. The case mentioned that if you change the code, you will also destroy the reputation. It will also destroy your strategic positioning. So the strategic positioning. Will be different.
If you ask me honestly, part A is easy. Part B, I can tell you, is difficult. Difficult in the sense that students, a lot of them, they only study the book one. They look at this, they will say, "Yo, see, they might not know what you want." So if you think, don't always think of the book. You read the requirement and you ask yourself, actually, what they want me to say is about strategic position. Then you think back, actually, that's what they want. So you say, okay? Alright, now C should be relatively easy. Now, see, they say, explain the statement that child labor is always wrong if you're using a deontological and teleological perspective. Okay, so if you start from deontological, now I would first say that explain the meaning of non-consequentialist theory. Okay, explain the meaning of non-consequentialist theory, that right or wrong does not depend on consequences. You don't have to talk about Kantian, it's okay, because we are just talking about the theory, okay? So you just have to say that right or wrong does not depend on consequences. There is always a universal acceptable principle
to evaluate the situation. Okay, so talk about consequentialist. Now then relate to absolutism. Okay, relate to absolutism. So both of these will tell you that there is a universal ethical principle, and it will not be affected by the consequences of the decision. So right or wrong doesn't affect by the consequences. Now then you must apply to the case, okay? Now if you apply to the case, if you look at the case, now we find that child labor is always wrong. Okay, it's always wrong because. So why would child labor be always wrong? Now, number one, the reason why we find child labor is wrong is, first, we believe that children, unlike adults, they are not like us. They don't know how to protect themselves. They do not know how to see what is dangerous, what is not dangerous. And their response power is not as good as us. So if there's any problem, they don't know how to respond. So this is one thing. So you put themselves into high danger. Yes, you know? Then number two, we also think that as children, you must be given your rights as children. Yes, you know? So children's rights is, you know how children should be. Yes, you know? So you don't bring the children into the adult's world. So you must leave them as a child to be naive, to enjoy their life so that they learn. Yes, you know? So it's always wrong because number one, we have safety concern. Okay? Now number two, we deprive their childhood from having proper education. Okay? So all these are the reason why it's always wrong. Now that's why if you say that, if you apply Kantian, you will say that I don't wish my child to be working. So this is the issue, okay? So the child labor is always wrong because of safety concern and so on. Now, so if you apply this ethics, that even if we have a valid commercial or legal justification, it is still morally wrong. Okay? For example, like they say the money is important. The case mentioned that the law allows. Okay? You must mention that, you know, you're gonna mention that even though you can give me a valid justification, but it's still wrong. Because in the first place, you know that they are not supposed to be there. Okay? Now, so this is from deontological. Now, teleological. Then you start to now explain that it depends on consequences. So if you get good outcome, then we will accept as morally correct. So that's why there is a relativism element. Okay, there's a relativism element in the sense that we can do a trade-off between the benefit and the adverse effect of a decision, that anything is acceptable if the benefit is more than the adverse effect. So there's a trade-off. So you ban,
you ban. Okay?
Now, so you got to say that we can actually look at two views. Either you are an egoist view or you go for utilitarianism. Now, if you go for an egoist view, then you probably will just look from your own point of view. So from your own point of view, example like HPC can save costs.
Because child labor is obviously cheaper, so you can save costs. That's all you want, okay?
Now, but from utilitarianism point of view, you will start to consider that the economic support for the children, for their family, the company can gain, then even the customer can buy at a lower price. So you start to think that actually this is good because everyone seems to benefit.
So this is from the teleological point of view.
This is how they ask Code of Ethics. So you see one question already.
Okay, now look at the question dealing with ethics on page 4. I think it's a question on independence.
Okay, first of all, explain why auditor independent is necessary in auditor client relationship. Which I think this one is very easy, right? The reason why you must have auditor to be independent is because of the duty that we take.
That because shareholder needed extra assurance. Alright.
And we cannot just trust one side, what the director says. So we want an extra assurance. So to get extra assurance, we must get someone independent to tell us. Okay? And number two, only when you have this so-called a confidence system that can give us an evaluation of their account, then only you can give so-called the director a fear that they do not simply do things. Your director know that shareholder will be aware of the problem, auditor will tell them. So you must do things properly, yes, you know, okay? Now, and then describe the three threats that you see in the case. This is A, yeah? Okay? Okay, now B, they say, N is experiencing some tension due to the conflict between the duty and responsibility as an employee of Fillmore Pierce and as a qualified professional accountant. So compare and contrast the duty and responsibility in the two roles, as employee and as professional accountant. But this one is a repeat question. Okay, we tried questions like that before. So now you see the question repeated. Huh? Then number two, explain the tension between the role that N is now experiencing. And the last part, how absolutist, which is a dogmatic and relativist pragmatic ethical assumption, could have affected N's decision. So that's why they're asking, if she is absolutist, what she's going to do? She is relativist, what she's going to do? Okay, now we read the case. Okay, it's the final day of a 2-week-long audit of Buren, a long-standing one of few more peers' auditor. Now in the afternoon, Anne, a recently qualified accountant and a member of the audit team, was following an audit trail on some cash payment when she discovered what she described to the audit partner Zachary as irregularity. So a large and material cash payment had been recorded with no recipient name. The corresponding invoice was handwritten on a scrap of paper and the signature was illegible. Now Zachary, the audit partner, was under pressure to finish the audit that afternoon. He advised Anne to seek an explanation from Frank Monroe, the client's finance director. Zachary told her that Van Buren was a long-standing client of Fillmore and he would be surprised if there was anything unethical or illegal about the payment. He said that he had personally been involved in Van Buren audit for the last 8 years and that it had always been without incident. He also said that Frank Monroe was an old friend of his from university days and that he was certain he wouldn't approve anything unethical or illegal. Zachary said Phil Moore had also done some consultancy for Van Buren, so it's very important that the client that is very, it's a very important client that he didn't want Anne to upset with unwelcome and uncomfortable questioning. Now this whole paragraph already can highlight to you the ethics threat, right? It's so clear, right? Not, it's much easier than an FA question. Example, they mentioned number one, you audit the client for so long already, correct? Not 8 years already, someone is the same partner, 8 years. Number two, old friend, you trusted the person. By right, auditor shouldn't have this kind of trust where you trusted the person. Number three, you do a lot of work for them, consulting work that you do not want to upset the client. See? You got three threats already, so simple, right? That's the part A, okay? Now, when Anne sought an explanation from Mr. Monroe, she was told that nobody could remember what the payment was for, but that she had to recognize that real audits were sometimes a bit messy and that not all the audit trail could end up as she might like them to. He also reminded her that it was a final day and both he and the audit firm were under time pressure to conclude the business and get the audit signed off. When Anne told Zachary what Frank had said, Zachary agreed not to get the audit signed off without Anne's support, but warned her that she should be very certain that the irregularity was worth delaying for the sign-off. It was therefore now Anne's decision whether to extend the audit or to sign it off by the end of the Friday afternoon. So now the boss pushed the problem to the staff. Yes, you know? So now you know what is the tension. One side, you'll be thinking that if I delay, then later no problem. Everyone is going to blame me. Yes, you know? If I don't delay, then got problem. So this is why there's a tension. So you don't know whether you should go ahead or not, okay? Now, so that is the question. So this question wasn't too difficult, right? Okay. Okay. Now, what is the importance of auditor independent? Now, it's quite simple. See, I can start explaining the purpose of an external audit. So I would tell them that external audit is meant to give shareholder or any other user. Reasonable assurance that financial statements are free of material misstatement. And then these financial statements are prepared by the management or the entity. Okay? Which are the responsibility of the directors. Okay? So, for the audit opinion to be credible, auditor has to be objective. Informing his opinion. Okay, so that is what we need. Okay, now, so for that, there are two requirements. Okay, there are two requirements. One is be
independent.
Now, be independent refers to independence of mind. And two is you appear independent. So that's your independent of appearance.
Now, these two requirements, they are of course being independent
of the entity that the auditor audits. Okay? Now, these two requirements is for two different things. First, when we say be independent or having independent of mind is to ensure that you will be able to come with a quality judgment. Okay, that is to make sure that there's a quality judgment. So independent of mind is about the quality judgment. So you don't have independence of mind, your opinion will be affected. Okay? So if you don't have, then opinion is okay, then independent of appearance. Now this is to ensure that public confidence is there. Because you want people to believe you. We can't see your mind, but we can see your behavior. That's why the confidence will come from appearance. So it's two different things. So you must be able to explain that. Okay? So the importance of auditors independent is because of your duty, and there are two requirements. This is why you need to be independent. You need to appear independent. You need to be independent. You must explain all that. Okay? Now then they ask you to identify three threats. Okay, one, Zakari is the same engagement partner for Van Buren for 8 years. So we see that there is a familiarity trap. Okay. Now, So how do you see the issue about the threat? Now nah, we can see that you must explain that once you become too close, you will lose professional skepticism. Now the case mentioned that he was surprised if that line.
Now when he mentioned he was surprised that if there's anything unethical, that means he don't believe. And the reason why a person don't believe is because you ain't trusted the company. You say that there's nothing wrong that you have been doing all these years. So that's why this is one thing that already show that his objectivity.
Has been impaired. Okay, so there's evidence that he's lost some degree of his objectivity. Now then number two, they also mentioned that Zachary and Frank are old friends. Now both are very senior position. They're capable to affect the outcome of the audit. Now again, you can say that there is a familiarity threat. Again, the case showed that he mentioned he was certain. Now again, when he used the word he was certain, you know,
I mean you're very sure, you know, you don't even need to check.
So that already show that you are not being objective, really. That you no longer decide based on evidence, you decide based on your feeling. Okay, now so again, he's not objective because this is not based on evident. Issue is they mentioned that Van Buren is a key important client to Fillmore, so there is some kind of undue dependent that Zachary is afraid of offending the client. Okay? Gonna lose them. So again, you quote the case. So there's this self-interest trap. So this is part A.
Okay, part B. Now part B, they say compare and contrast the duty. That what is the role of a worker and the role of the company? Now, role as a worker means you are looking at the organization.
Then the role as an accountant means your professional role. Okay, now, so the two things that we have here. Okay, the organizational role. Now, you must act in the best interest of the employer as well as your superior. Because we can see that obviously N is fit into the organization. There must be a hierarchy. Okay? So N is probably reporting to her superior. So she must serve them. So example of what you need to do in terms of that role as an employee. Okay? Now you probably will need to complete your duty in a timely, carefully manner. Okay, now your duty of keeping secrets confidential. Agree? Huh? So as a worker, right? Now you must avoid any conflict of interest. So anything that conflicts with the company, you better avoid. So you give an example, what kind of conflict? Like maybe you are an accountant, your boss is doing accounting firm, but you privately go out and take accounting job and do at home. It's not right. Okay? Or you take the job from outside, worse still. You come to the company and use the accounting system and do outside account. This is all wrong already. So this is your duty as a worker. Now, as a worker, you are expected to comply with the organization's norms. Okay? Comply with organization's norms, expectation. So if you remember, this is stage 3 of Coburg. Okay? You're interpersonal. So you expect to follow what everyone believes in. Okay? So if your worker, your boss is like that, you might be like that. Huh? Your manager is lazy, you might be lazy. Okay? So you don't become hardworking. You become hardworking, then you become very irritating. Huh? Correct enough? Everyone is lazy, then you become so hardworking. That means you show them that even more lazy. Because, you know, that's why you go to government office. Become a government servant. You cannot be hardworking. Right? You become hardworking, very hard to survive. Right? You must be lazy. That's why a lot of people, they go into government service, after civil service. After some time, they will naturally all become very lazy. Their attitude will change. Because, you know, so this is the problem. It's because you must live in the environment. So that's what we expect from you as a worker. Now then, as a professional. Okay, as a professional, what do you expect that you need to have as a professional? Now, of course, these are the same thing, that you must act or comply with the profession's code. Okay, now you will need to defend the interests of the public, the interests of the profession. Okay, you have to defend the interests of the profession. Okay, because you represent the profession, you must always avoid anything that is illegal or disrepute the profession. And whenever you have a dilemma, you should resolve using the professional code or the principle. Now, this is what we expect you to do, okay, as a professional, And now we notice that there is a tension because there's a conflict between the two roles above. Okay, so there's a tension because there seems to be a conflict between the two roles above. Now, in which way we see that there's a conflict in two roles? Now, see, being an employee, she's supposed to live up to the expectation of the peer and the colleagues and her superior. And you can see that Zachary is in a position of believing the client. Okay, Zachary is in a position of believing the client. That means the partner is in a position of not trusting that there will be any irregularity. Okay? Now, so Zachary warned Anne that she has to make sure the delay is worth. That means there is an intimidation. And from that intimidation, you can feel that. So if the outcome proves that Anne was wrong, then this will actually create a very negative impact to her working relationship. So if you start to think of all this, then she probably be motivated to just overlook, no? So she probably be thinking that I am just forgetting that, don't question so much. Now this is her one part, that being a worker, she has this kind of concern, okay? That she's not sure of what to do. But if you look at being a professional, so the issue that we're going to bring here, that being a professional is what? Now being a professional means you must look at the duty of an auditor is to serve the interests of the shareholder. Okay? So the shareholder is the public because they rely on the work of the auditor. Remember? Because I mentioned today in the afternoon, public is what? Public is the people that will make use of your work. So, in this point, the public is the shareholder because the audit report is given to them. So, if you want to protect the interests of the public, then you will make sure that you do a proper audit. So, that's why to protect public interests, you need to ensure that there is a thorough audit. And it's clear that the standard requires auditor to exercise professional skepticism. So you have to investigate and you have to delay the sign off.
So you gotta mention about public interest, and when you talk about public interest, you must talk about shareholder, because shareholder is the public in this case. Okay, so we protect public interest means we protect shareholder. So if you don't go in question, that means you will actually affect the shareholder's interest. Now this is a tension. So this is the format. So that's why there's a tension, because if you look at being a worker, we should just stop. Okay, don't question. But being a professional, you should delay and question. So that's why there's a conflict, okay? There's a tension, right? Okay, so they say, how would an absolutist or relativist assumption would affect the outcome of your decision? Now, so absolutist or relativist, what's the difference? Okay, relativist.
So if relativist, how would she decide?
Delay.
Don't delay.
Overlook the matter. Are you sure?
More.
Talk about consequentialist in different ways. Relativist moment. Relativist by how the people in your locality view the thing. Taifan now got egoist, utilitarianism, If you talk about relativism, relativism, the meaning is right or wrong depends on the view of the society. So if the people that think this is right, then you do. If the people that think it's not right, then you do. So whether you are, if you are using relativism, whether or not you should investigate or overlook, actually it depends on what the people there believe. That means you cannot decide immediately. So she must go and ask a colleague. If all the manager colleagues, she asks, everyone in the company around her say that no need, then she said, okay, then no need. Because that's what they believe in. But of course, if she go and ask, even though the partner say no need, or the partner say not sure, but everyone else say, I think yeah, you must go and check. If everyone support her, then yes, she will have to delay. Okay? So this is what you must do. So when you answer your part C, okay, then there is a need for you to define relativism, that decision whether is ethically right or wrong depends. The perception, culture, or the belief of the society. So this is situational. Situational means it can be wrong for a society, but can be right to another. Now that is called
relativism.
So you don't straight away talk about look at consequences. If you talk about look at consequences, you're explaining consequentialism. Okay? But of course, we know people who are consequentialists are definitely relativists. Because consequentialism shows that you can ban them. This will show you can ban them, but you must explain the right thing, okay?
Now, then after that, you talk about what is absolutism. That there is a universally accepted ethical principle. Okay? There's universally acceptable ethical principle. So you just explain that something is right, then it will always right no matter where are you. Okay? So you must highlight, you know, it's no matter where are you. And don't say no matter what's the consequences. You must say no matter where are you. Because we are talking about situation. Whether you're in this place or that place is the same. For example, you believe humans should be equal right. You're in Malaysia also equal right. Arab also equal right. US also equal right. Okay, although you know that equal right doesn't apply to places like Arab. So that's why you go there, but you still think it's like that, it's like that. Okay, so this is about absolutism. Now, so if you apply this to the case, the outcome to end decision. So how will this affect her decision? Now, if she uses relativism, then she shall evaluate what is the moral value of the society in the case can be my colleagues. Okay? So if everyone around her believe it is right to overlook, then she shall do so. Because you are looking at the way how people around you believe. Okay? Now definitely if she is an absolutist, then she shall pursue. Because as auditor, okay, you need to have your professional skepticism. So you cannot ignore your suspicion or your doubts. So that is how the examiner tested questions to do with independent, and then a bit of ethics, profession, okay, profession, professionalism, all this is how they bring together, okay. Now we look at page 1. Okay. So this is also on ethics. So you still can see how examiner can ask ethics, okay? Alright, first of all, analyze Jenny's and Alan's motivation for adopting the code of ethics using normative and instrumental forms of stakeholder theory. Actually, the normative or instrumental, I mean to be more specific lah. Normative, you say stakeholder, correct lah, huh? Instrumental should be towards the, which theory? Normative is towards stakeholder theory. Instrumental is actually, huh? Come on? Reward lah. 不是, 什么 theory? Stakeholder theory and 这个是什么 theory? Huh? Agency theory?
So we are before, right? So if you are looking at instrumental, means you are looking more of, like she say, reward, money, gain. So profit. So profit all is for shareholder one. Normative is more charitable, is more philanthropic, is very altruistic. That means very kind. So when you're being kind, means you're not being kind to shareholder, you're being kind to everyone. Being very, very kind to everyone is very cruel to shareholder. Because these are all money of the company. You take and do good things. So this is the part. So they ask you to look at their motivation from these two perspectives. Okay, B.
Assess Jenny's decision on the possible apology for the offending image from a conventional and pre-conventional moral development. That means we are looking at Coburg. So if you use a conventional and pre-conventional moral development, what is her decision going to be? And then C, explain and assess the factor that the board of JH Graphic might consider in deciding how to respond to the controversy over the offending image. And then D, comment on the legitimacy of the religious group's claim on JH Graphic's activity. So this is a questions on ethics, a bit on stakeholder theory, a bit on stakeholder claim and so on, okay? Now, the board of JH Graphics, a design and artwork company, was debating an agenda item on the possible adoption of a corporate code of ethics. Jenny Harris, the chief executive, and majority shareholder, was the leading supporter of the idea. She said that many of large companies in the industry had adopted code of ethics, and that she thought it would signal the importance that JH Graphics placed on ethics. She also said that she was personally driven by high ethical value, and that she wanted to express this through her work and through the company's activities and policy. Now, Alan Leroy, the creative director, explained that he would support the adoption of the code of ethics as long as it helped to support the company's long-term strategic objective. He said that he could see no other reason, as company was not a charity and had to maximize shareholder value above all other objectives. In particular, he was keen, as a shareholder himself, to know what the code could cost to draw up, how much it could cost to comply with it over and above the existing costs. Now, Jenny argued that having a code of ethics would help to resolve some ethical issue, one of which she suggested was a problem that the company was having over a particular image that had recently produced for a newspaper advertisement. Now, the image was produced for an advertising client. And although the client was pleased, it had offended a particular religious group because of the content and the design. And when this was discovered, who had produced the offending image? Some religious leader criticized JH Graphic for being insensitive and offensive to their religion. And for a brief time, the event was a major news story. As politicians, journalists, and others debated this issue in the media, the board of JH Graphics was involved in intense discussion and faced with the dilemma as to whether or not to issue a public apology for the offense caused by the image and to ask the client to withdraw it. Now, Alan argued that having a code of ethics would not have helped in that situation as the issue was so complicated. His view was that the company should not apologize for the image, and he didn't care very much that the image offended people. He said it was bringing the company free publicity and that was good for the business. Jenny said that she had sympathy for the viewpoint of the offended religious leader. Although she disagreed with them, she understood the importance to some people of firmly held belief. The board agreed that as there seems to be argument both ways, decision on how should deal with the image should be Jenny as the chief executive. So this is the issue. So commenting last time, you always hear this in newspaper. Okay, like people draw a picture about Nabi Muhammad, then after that, you will see the Muslims start to protest. This kind of thing. Okay, now, so first of all, okay. Now, what is normative and what is instrumental? So I think I will explain first of all. I would define normative. Okay, normative must be something that is more altruistic. Consider it. You must consider it. Tolerance. Okay? So, it is an ethical motivation that sees okay, between the need to generate profit to shareholder as well as to take care of the interests of other stakeholder. So the company is not to satisfy the needs of the shareholder alone. So this is called normative. That's why it's very altruistic, considerate, and high tolerant. Okay, you must take care of other people. So instrumental means, this is where you become profit driven, pro capital. Okay, you become profit driven, you become pro capital. Now here, the ethical motivation is towards protecting only the capital provider. Now we only protect the people that they contribute to. For example, like shareholder. For example, customer. Now, the rest of the people that they don't contribute money to us, we do not need to protect them, okay? So this is the idea. So that's why we do something that what the client wants. We do something what the shareholder wants. So that's why in this case, we will only justify the interest of the capital provider, example like investors, customers. So the company is of no obligation to take care of the others. But that's the difference. Now that's why if you really look at it, agency theory is instrumental. Okay? Pristine capitalist is instrumental. Because these are all the people that you need to have a profit. Stakeholder theory is normative one. Or if you put under your social contract or social ecologies, these are normative one. Okay, so you must start by explaining all that. Okay, after you explain all that, then which one is which? You must bring in the case here. Jenny is definitely normative motivated. Now why is she so-called normative motivated? Now if you see the case mentioned, now Jenny is a person that she believes in ethics. Okay? She is personally driven with high ethical value. Okay? She said that this must be expressed through the company's activity and policy. And this must be embedded in the company's activity and policy, which means whatever the company is doing, it must also reflect the same value. And of course, when you are instrumental, you cannot be too much on ethical value because you're profit driven. So that's why this is the difference. So definitely she is normative. Then number two, we can see that she is concerned with offending the religious group, which is a stakeholder of a company. She sympathize them. That means she shows concern to these people. Even though clearly that this group of people has no economic relationship with the company. Okay? Now, and we can see Alan is instrumental. Now why Alan is instrumental? Because first he is questioning the need of the code for the company's benefit. Now he is not against the code, but he is against if the code will give cost more than benefit.
He never say he don't believe in the code. He just say that before you want to do, he wants to see what is the cause of drawing up the code, how much to comply, then only he decide. And he believed that the company's purpose is to make money for shareholder and not as a charity. So the word charity implied that company should not be socially responsible. Okay, right, this is part A.